Good morning, everybody. I'm happy to see that you survived. It's the last day of our winter school, and as you saw from the program, we're gradually building up the things, going from the technical part in ultrasound, the acquisition processing. Yesterday we talked a little bit about the individual patient, what do we need to know for diagnosis, assessment, or for treatment. And today we go a little bit more towards population analysis, because when you look at ultrasound, since it's the most used and by far, as we saw in the beginning, the most used imaging technology in cardiology, it's very important to see how we can use it, how we can use it not only to treat the individual patient, but also to learn something about cardiology. And as Alan will likely say also, is still a lot of controversy, because in most medical clinical trials about drugs or devices, imaging is not used or is hardly used. And that is still a problem. And there's different reasons for this problem. One is obviously what you heard yesterday from Eric, is that things are not as simple as it just looks like. It's not just taking one image and you have the answer. But it's actually more complex. It's not only the complexity of interpreting, but it's also the complexity of all the politics behind it and things like that, the regulations, the guidelines and things like that. So today we will start first with talking about this, and then later on we will talk about also what's with regard to this. And then obviously, we already mentioned it a few times, things like machine learning come in, and then later on we'll talk about that. First of all, it's my pleasure to introduce Alan Fraser, professor in Cardiff University and visiting professor in Leuven also. We know each other for quite a long time. As a Scotsman working in Wales. Alan is actually an anticlinical cardiologist, and he's involved in quite a lot of research. He has done a lot with ventricular arterial coupling and things like that, a lot with deformation imaging. He was also at the beginning of the use in larger population of Doppler imaging. So these are all the things that he did from the research side. But from the other side, and that might interest some people also, he's involved in regulation currently of devices with the European Commission. And additionally, he's also been involved quite a lot with the European Society of Cardiology from the more organizational point of view. So that's why it's my pleasure to have Alan here, since he has this broad view from the clinic to the regulation to the research. And I hope you can enlighten us a little bit more, Alan, on this topic. Welcome.
Thank you, Bart. That's not one topic, that's multiple topics, but I'll try and do justice. Thank you to you and to Matt, who's here, I presume, somewhere. Sorry, I'm looking way past you, I apologize for the invitation and for the challenge to try and cover some broader aspects of cardiovascular imaging in clinical practice and research. This is one of my hobbies now, so this is my concept of an audience in a lecture theater. You can identify with one of these creatures if you like, but I'm just showing it so that I introduce a different tone. I want you to interrupt and be interactive. This is what I do on Friday afternoons. You can see it's a slightly odd pursuit. But please interrupt and ask questions and comment if you disagree with anything. Now, we like to believe that we practice rational, evidence-based medicine, the model of Western medicine, which has been actually very successful in many ways, but I would like to question some of the bases. And if I summarize what I think we like to believe, which is that we start with questions, evidence, an enormous amount of data, which we cannot possibly, any one of us, read anymore. That's just completely impossible. So the synthesis of multiple sources of evidence is crucial for us to understand what to keep abreast of developments. And of course, we hope that clinical practice is based on the evidence in a rational way, and that what we do for patients not only makes them feel better, but helps them to live longer or have a better quality of life. So there should be a link from clinical research to improving outcomes. And to monitor how we're getting on in clinical practice, we now do audit in various forms to show whether or not we're meeting best practice, and if we're not, we try and educate ourselves in a continuous loop to improve what we do. The education should also, of course, be rational and based on the evidence, and we hope that if outcomes are suboptimal, then we go back and think again and continue this circle. Now, this is true both for clinical practice and treatment, but also, of course, for diagnosis. And the rational basis for medicine that we practice in Europe and elsewhere is making a proper diagnosis. But in fact, when you analyze this, 10 to 30% of patients get the wrong diagnosis or an incomplete diagnosis. It's far from perfect. It's based on our clinical assessment as practitioners, and that doesn't always work. So let me start with a comment about regulation, which Bart mentioned. This was a paper that we published 5 years ago, 6 years ago now, on how to, on what we considered were the problems with medical devices in Europe and how they were regulated. And diagnostic imaging mostly are class 2 medical devices, but they are governed by the directives and the new regulation on medical devices in Europe and approved by notified bodies to whom the manufacturers submit applications. But then, and still now, when we consider diagnostic imaging, there are no standard reference laboratories to test equipment that does the same thing. There are no standard phantoms that would allow every manufacturer to test their systems against the same external reference criterion. And there is no requirement on manufacturers to report the performance of the systems that they sell to us as far as clinical outcomes are concerned. They have to confirm that the systems perform the tasks that they claim they will do, but those basically are technical tasks rather than clinical ones. And so last year, for the first time, in the context of the forthcoming revision of the medical device legislation in Europe, which will be implemented this year, there was an advisory document published by the European Commission. It's a MedDev document, medical device advisory document. This is voluntary, so it's only guidance for manufacturers and notified bodies. But for the first time in Europe, it was suggested that manufacturers could consider submitting performance data not just on the technical aspects of diagnostic imaging, but on some clinical implications, such as reproducibility, including both reporting and acquisition, diagnostic performance with sensitivity and specificity, and with positive and negative predictive values according to different pretest probabilities. That's a Bayesian approach. You know that the same test with a positive answer does not mean the same thing depending on the population in whom you've performed the test. If there's a very low pretest probability, then the significance of the test is much less than with a very high pretest probability. So this is very important too. It also included the suggestion that versions of software should be logged and their differences and their impact should be available. I have known clinical colleagues do research projects or use ultrasound imaging machines where they have obtained different answers from on previous occasions and couldn't understand why this happened until they realized the company had changed the software without telling anyone. The latest upgrade of software in a diagnostic system can change the results that we get, but this is not always advertised to the clinical users. So what was recommended here, I was a member of this group of regulators, was that iterations of software should be logged and publicly available so that whatever happens may have implications for clinical practice and should be recognized. And there was also a suggestion that companies should help to produce normal values. I find it rather strange that you can buy a very expensive machine for 1 or 2 million euros if it's magnetic resonance imaging. And the company will tell you you can get pictures of the heart, but they won't tell you what's normal. You have to work that out yourself. And there's a problem with overdiagnosis in medicine as well that partly relates to these phenomena. So let me start with some of these issues, which I consider, if you like, to be the basic science of diagnostic imaging. Without knowing these things, we can't start to use diagnostic tools properly in clinical practice. And this goes back a long way. You may have heard of the Cochrane Collaboration, which is now a worldwide consortium, if you like, or collaboration of academic experts to produce systematic reviews and summaries of the evidence in medicine. It's named after Archie Cochrane here, who was a Scotsman who was a professor in Wales. He was an epidemiologist and a respiratory physician. And I was interested in the context of the Cochrane Collaboration to go back to this study published in 1963. A very simple study that they did in the Rhondda Fach, which is one of the mining valleys in South Wales. And they took 537 electrocardiograms from miners and gave them to four observers to report whether or not these ECGs were normal or abnormal. And you see that the concordance was directly proportional to the number of observers. The more observers you had, the less the concordance. In fact, only 5% or less was their concordance in all of these ECGs amongst all five observers. So it's a very early demonstration of inter-observer variability in the simplest possible way. You have a question?
Yes. Could that be related to the definition of normal and abnormal, and where is the threshold where the observer is defining the patient abnormal?
Absolutely. All sorts of factors, from perception and thinking to criteria and recordings and everything else, yes. All these things are included. And in fact, this is not imaging, this is just the ECG. This is an example of a stress test in a 69-year-old man with chest tightness, with angina, who has risk factors for vascular disease, diabetes, high blood pressure, and cholesterol. And you see that the electrocardiogram at rest is normal, with normal ST segments. On peak exercise, we see some changes, but the most marked changes occur during the recovery phase after stopping exercise. And you can see this plotted by the machine, which is plotting the slope of the ST segment here and the amount of depression of the ST segment, which is more than 3 millimeters. That's a very positive stress test for those of us who look at this. But here to relate to an individual patient is a nice early summary, if you like, of parametric statistical imaging, if you like, for the performance of a diagnostic test. Because what Håkan Kronander and his colleagues in Sweden did was analyze nearly 1,900 stress tests, and they looked at the positivity and the diagnostic value of each of the 12 leads of the electrocardiogram at each minute during exercise to the end of exercise and each minute afterwards in men and women. And this is a plot of the statistical significance of ST segment, in each gender, at each stage. And in fact, you see that the most diagnostic information comes 1 to 2 minutes after exercise, both in men and women. You see that the test is more useful in men than in women, and you see which leads are most useful, including, for example, lead AVR, which traditionally we're not taught to look at. So this is a very nice, simple summary of how we can get much more detailed diagnostic information from a careful analysis that should influence routine clinical practice. What about echocardiography? This is a study that we did. Janice Swampalai was a research fellow of mine, looking at 61 individuals, and that's important for a proper inter-observer study. You need a large number of individuals. And these subjects were all scanned twice by each observer on two occasions on and twice at each visit. So it was twice in one morning by two observers and then repeated on a second visit, so that we could look at the variability due to acquiring the images, the variability due to measuring them, and variability over time. This is what should be done properly, but very often studies of reproducibility may just look at measurement, for example, which is not really enough. And if you compare it with blood pressure and heart rate, which have coefficients of variation of less than 5%, and that compares with laboratory assays, if you go to a clinical chemistry laboratory and measure sodium in the blood, they would expect a coefficient of variation of about 1%. But what we found, unsurprisingly, is that the variability increases from one observer to two observers to two time periods. And these happen to be measurements of arterial function in the carotid artery, which is an interest of mine, as Bart said. But you see that for some of these variables, these are wave reflections measured non-invasively, we have coefficients of variation of about 30%. The best we could get was the forward compression wave between 10 and 20%. But it's just an example of how we should be analyzing any new imaging method. A second example, also from a study that we did, and Andre Margulescu published this, looking at this index of isovolumic acceleration, which is the most load insensitive measurement of contractile function of the left ventricle. This is the velocity of the muscle of the left ventricle shortening towards the apex during the QRS complex on the electrocardiogram. So before the ventricle starts to empty, while it changes shape as it builds up pressure, the rate of change is actually a very good index of contractile function. And we can measure it from the slope of this response as acceleration. But what we're showing here is the reproducibility of the test in a healthy, normal population by a correlation, by a coefficient of variation, by the feasibility of the test, and by a Bland-Altman analysis, all the traditional methods for assessing reproducibility. And the point of the slide is that when we go from a healthy population to a group of patients with subclinical disease, they had type 2 diabetes, or to patients with heart failure, in whom we might be most interested in using this test for diagnosis, you see the performance becomes worse. The feasibility of just obtaining information drops to 82%, and the variability as the coefficient of variation goes up to 25%. So we need to assess observer, machine, patient population, and this is also looking now with the collaboration between the European and American Imaging Associations at inter-machine variability. I'm not sure whether Jan de Hoche may have commented on this when he was here earlier in the week. But
not
there
really.
Is a
he was mainly talking about Doppler versus speckle tracking, so it's good.
There's a very nice ongoing collaboration between all the major vendors, including Philips, whose premises we're on at the moment, but all the major vendors of ultrasound machines, and some companies such as Tomtec and Epsilon, which are vendor-independent imaging platforms just with software-based analysis. And all of these companies have taken a virtual data set, a digitally constructed data set, into their own systems for analysis. And we can now compare the performance of different machines on virtual data sets that are designed to represent normal ventricles, hypertrophied ventricles, ventricles exercising at faster heart rates with fewer data points, and enlarged ventricles. And you can see absolute errors around the mean value are pretty tight, but there are differences between companies. And the relative percentage errors, which can go up to 25% for stress equivalent virtual imaging. So this sort of information, this is the first time this has ever been done to my knowledge, and it's important. We wouldn't want to buy an expensive car without knowing its performance or its petrol consumption. it's diesel consumption, whatever you use. This is now an example of starting to get objective evidence that we can use to compare machines. Matt?
Yeah, I wanted to comment that I think, if I'm not mistaken, that this is done on the synthetic data.
This is synthetic data, absolutely.
And so it's interesting to confront this to your slide before. You show that the accuracy really depends on the population, because probably the main difference between this population is image quality, and that's why you degrade the performances. And so here, if you look at the type of data set, this is a much easier task than processing a real image.
Yes.
So it could be that in a real data set, the variability would be even bigger.
Absolutely. This is, if you like, the best case, because we know ground truth. As you say, it's a synthetic data set, and every company got the same raw data for analysis. But the same collaborators, and I'm part of the group that monitors these activities, have also done it with clinical imaging, now in patients, with a whole number of different systems. And they have compared, for example, global longitudinal strain between different manufacturers in the same patients. And they kept the operator constant between each of these. This was published 2 years ago. And the blue dots represent comparisons where there are significant differences between diagnostic imaging systems. So you see that most of the comparisons are different if you take Philips versus GE or Siemens versus Hitachi. You can see that you cannot extrapolate images from one system to another. Now, this is never routinely implemented in clinical practice. We do not specify when you go to have a repeat echocardiogram that you use the same machine that you used the last time. That doesn't happen. This is a source of variability or error, which becomes increasingly important as we move to quantitative imaging, objective measurements rather than visual analysis. Now, those are...
So we see a bit the same. We're doing ultrasound measures on bone to detect osteoporosis, and we have and we found that it's much more difficult at people with diseased bones. So the failure rate and the reproducibility becomes worse as more osteoporotic the patients become. What's the reason for this? Is it as well that the tissue properties become more difficult to analyze, or why is it?
I should think there are multiple reasons, and everyone here could produce them. It's image quality, it's noise, interference patterns, plus inter-observer variability, plus sampling error, because bone may be different at different sites if it's diseased, where it may be more uniform if it's healthy, plus, of course, between machines, the variability introduced by the company-specific software used to analyze the raw data from the imaging. And that's usually sampled with different spatial and temporal resolution by different companies in different ways, with different smoothing algorithms and splines that are fitted and all these things, which we don't think about clinically. And I'm sure others could suggest other reasons, but there are many. Bart, did you want to comment?
What seems to be also in cardiology and imaging is that a lot of the errors are actually absolutely the same, whatever your mean value. And that makes that, of course, most disease patients have decreased values, but if the absolute or the error remains absolutely the same, in percentage-wise, you get a bigger error.
Yeah.
I don't know the reason for it. So it's counterintuitive for most scientists, but that seems to be the case.
That does happen. So the relative error is greater when the function is least, yes. The imprecision, as I've shown you, increases the more diseased the patient, which is what you're saying as well.
Before going into the software specification between different companies, is there a comparison on the raw data registered by all of these machines? In that case,
the comparison, the previous slide that I showed you, was using the same raw data from a virtual data set, but the companies will not disclose how they store raw data or how they analyze it. That's company-specific intellectual property that they don't have to disclose and they don't want to tell us. So the way that this was done with this analysis was a compromise to give the companies the raw data so that they didn't have to tell us how they analyzed it, they just gave us the answers.
Maybe just a comment on this, which I think is also quite interesting. This is testing analysis software, and from the simulations, you got raw data, so you could really get the RF data, was given to the people that wanted it, but there are several manufacturers, I think including Philips, if I'm not wrong, that couldn't use the RF data in their pipeline, that needed to go from the DICOM data because they didn't have themselves even access to the RF data when they did the analysis. So it really depends on the company, how the pipeline is going, where they work on, how the software is. Some use raw data, raw DICOM data, and others can only work on the scan converted data. So there's still there is a huge amount of difference. So if you then want to at some point look at raw data from a phantom or from a patient and compare these, totally impossible because the companies are so secretly with their RF data that there's no way they can be shared.
In the MRI field, there is an initiative to have a uniformized raw data. So some researcher defined a format, and now from each vendor, you can take a an analysis, extract the raw data, and reconstruct with the same algorithm from scratch. Mm-hmm.
But what we're discussing, I think, is a basic principle that when cardiac ultrasound started in the 1950s and subsequently when we got cross-sectional imaging in the 1980s, diagnosis was made by visual analysis, qualitative analysis of patterns of motion or just things we could see. Now we're moving to a much more sophisticated era of quantitative data from imaging systems, but I think paradoxically it is making our life in some ways more difficult because we see differences between manufacturers and it's more difficult to define what's normal and abnormal because we see a continuous gradation of function. Just for context, I've shown you the variability of measurements studied as the coefficient of variation. And for any cardiac imaging measurement, we would be pleased with a coefficient of variation of 10% or less. I showed you some examples. And in fact, if we take something simple like left ventricular ejection fraction or left ventricular diastolic or systolic volume measured by the Simpson method from a two-chamber or a four-chamber view, we are talking about coefficients of variation of 10 to 20%. Now, what that means is illustrated here by the concept of the reference change value, which is not used sufficiently in clinical practice, in my opinion. And that is the difference between one measurement and another measurement that we can be sure is a real difference, and not a variation that would be within the range of the precision of the measurement. And if you have a coefficient of variation of 10%, and one patient, that difference is a 28% difference between one measurement and the next one. And so often we say that the ejection fraction was 40%, it's now 45%, the patient's better. That's no different. But we do so many things like that that we need to think about realistically in clinical practice. And these are the numbers. If you have a coefficient of variation of 20%, that actually gives us, this is the blue line, a lot of power. Once we have 100 subjects, we can see a mean difference between groups of only 6%. So these are good enough for clinical trials and studies, but in the individual patient, we need to think about how we apply this. And any new methods that you're involved in evaluating should be tested against these sorts of criteria. So this is a summary from a paper that was published some time ago, 2009, from the American Heart Association, of how we should evaluate any new test in clinical practice. We need to be sure that the concept is appropriate. We've got the right idea. We're measuring or testing the right variable. We need to see whether it predicts the development of outcomes. We need to see whether it's better or adds information to diagnostic tests that we already have. Does it change treatment? does it improve outcomes in a randomized trial, and is it cost effective? This is standard for any biomarker, and imaging is a type of biomarker. We talk about imaging biomarkers, but we rarely do all these things with any new diagnostic test, because I said at the beginning, the manufacturers don't need to do this. They give us tools and they leave us to see how to use them. Let me just show, I think I've got two or three examples. The first is measuring carotid intima media thickness. This is a longitudinal image of the common carotid artery with a linear array transducer over the carotid artery. And you can see the carotid bifurcation to the internal and external carotid arteries. This is a very standard technique because it's an accessible large artery. We can't image the aorta in so much detail with high-frequency transducers. But when you do this in patients, and here are two examples that we studied, two adults of the same age, you can see one of them with a very thin thickness of the carotid intima and media, the two of the three layers of the artery, relatively small at 3 millimeters. And here's another subject of the same age with a much thicker carotid intima and media. These are two studies that we performed as part of a life cohort study coordinated by the Medical Research Council in the UK. And this marker of the carotid is very often used as a test for vascular health, thought to reflect atherosclerosis at other sites. But in fact, when you look at it, this is carotid intima media thickness. In this summary analysis, it only adds up to 3% in predictive value from a receiver operating characteristic curve, the C statistic, or the area under the curve. And the reclassification, maybe up to 10% of subjects will be reclassified. And this is how it compares with other tests of vascular function, flow-mediated dilatation for the endothelium, looking at plaque in the carotid, which is more useful, and measuring calcification in the coronary arteries with CT imaging. But the key message is that this analysis of thickness of the internal layer of the carotid artery has been studied in many, many drug trials, and drug treatment will reduce it. But it has never been shown that the reduction in intima media thickness translates to clinical events. And probably this is an epiphenomenon. It's just an adaptive vascular response to age and blood pressure that's been suggested. So this is something that people have spent many, many thousands of hours, millions of hours studying and using as a surrogate imaging endpoint. And yet, it's never been shown to impact outcomes. So it's probably the wrong idea, tested far too much. And when we analyzed this, Katerina Naka, who was with me, studied the guidelines of the European Society of Cardiology at that time, 2013 and 2012, both of which suggested that you could scan the carotid arteries as a measurement of risk. But in these guidelines, at that time, 99 or 84 systematic reviews and meta-analyses had been published, but the guidelines referred to a tiny proportion of these documents. And when you looked at the clinical trials, hundreds of them, the number that were referenced in these guidelines was tiny. This is not adequate summary of the evidence. And they got the answer wrong. And we sent a paper to the European Society of Cardiology, to the Heart Journal, and we got a review back saying this should be published, and a second review saying, I write guidelines, this is impossible, don't publish it. So it wasn't published. The guidelines have now been changed, and this has been removed from the most recent version, so perhaps we influenced them. But the point I want to make is that the evidence should be a thorough summary, and I'll come back to that. Second example, measuring left ventricular function. We all use ejection fraction. I think it's been discussed already this week. Go back to the original source, and it was first published in 1962 by Eugene Braunwald, a very eminent American cardiologist whose names some of you will know. And that was in the early days of cardiac catheterization, invasive measurement of the heart. They needed to start to put numbers on the function of the left ventricle because they were injecting radiological contrast medium and they could analyze the performance. And so they came up with this concept. But it's a ratio, and a ratio doesn't tell us what's happening underneath. In fact, they showed that stroke volume correlated with end diastolic volume, and they showed differences between healthy subjects and those with mitral stenosis and those with heart attack or aortic valve disease. But that is what has led to the use of ejection fraction. Now, what happens if we try and get normal data? This is an example of what we should do more of. This is an international consortium of multiple population studies around the world, coordinated by colleagues in New Zealand and now published, called Echo Normal, where they took 51,000 subjects to start with, excluded those who were younger than 18 or older than 18, those who had disease or who had abnormal risk factors, and they were left with a population of 23,000 healthy subjects, so that they could produce not just normal values, but what we call normative values, which means a big enough sample of normal healthy subjects to be an accurate reflection of the whole population. And for diagnostic imaging, we need normative databases, and that is now possible with big data and computing and international collaborations. This is what they showed in men and women by age and by ethnic group. And there are differences between all these groups. That's the point. And they showed the regression curves, and they plotted the lower limit of normal, which is different in men and women and different by ethnic group. And these are the actual numbers. The fifth centile, a 50-year-old European man has a normal ejection fraction if it's over 47%, but a 70-year-old Asian woman, it would be 56%. So these sort of data exist, but do we use them in clinical practice? This is my conceptual model of how the ventricle works. It's actually the long axis function of the ventricle that declines with time. Radial function increases, and ejection fraction is maintained by the increased radial function with the reduced longitudinal function and the change in shape of the ventricle. It becomes more spherical as we get older. From the age of 20 to 80, the heart becomes about 10 to 20% more spherical. And it works best as a piston, if you like, here on the right. So ejection fraction is another example of the wrong measurement that we use historically. Heart failure with preserved ejection fraction, in my opinion, is on a continuous scale. Now, this is a summary of, on the left, risk factors, in the middle, pathophysiological processes, and on the right, a variety of diseases. I won't go through this in detail, but each of these has been reported to be related to reduced long axis function of the left ventricle in a continuous manner. It's not an all or none phenomenon, but it's a graded response. And so we need to think about these as influences on normal function of the left ventricle. It becomes very difficult to know what is abnormal and what is normal, since it changes with age, physical activity, blood pressure, and everything else. And the only way that we can cope with that is by more sophisticated decision tools. But that's the background to ejection fraction. What do we read in the guidelines? Well, they were new guidelines on heart failure published by the European Society of Cardiology last year, 2016. The first sentence in the document says that guidelines summarize all available evidence at the time that the guidelines were produced. And yet, they go on to say the main term to describe heart failure is historical. Nothing to do with evidence, we'll just go with history. That's illogical. I've shown you what they should be using. Instead, they say we'll typically consider normal as more than 50%. and I was on one guidelines recommendation group where we decided what normal ejection fraction was by a show of hands. Would we choose 50, 45 or 40? And we voted. And that document has now been cited 1,500, 2,000 times in the literature, recommendations for diagnosing diastolic heart failure. So it's not logical. We need to change how we behave in clinical practice, and I hope you can help us. But they also, in that document, for the first time, introduce a new name. They now are defining patients with an ejection fraction of 40 to 49% as heart failure mid-range ejection fraction. This is a continuous variable with a normal distribution, and I've shown you that if you have a coefficient of variation to measure ejection fraction of 10 to 20%, we cannot tell 28% variability. So the whole of this range is within the diagnostic reproducibility of the test. This to me is utterly illogical, and I don't understand why they made this decision. But it's the problem that we have translating evidence and advanced diagnostic imaging and normative databases into clinical practice. I think this is confusing things. I think it's the wrong measurement done in the wrong way, but we could discuss that for hours. So we have a lot of evidence in diagnostic imaging, but if we're to use it both for trials and in patients, what's crucial is that we summarize it well and appropriately. And this is my last example, the new recommendations on diagnosing diastolic dysfunction of the left ventricle from the European and American imaging societies, just published last year, and they categorize multiple abnormal variables just into three separate groups. But they do this on the basis of 8 variables, and 8 factorial gives you 40,000 different combinations of these variables, but they're reduced to 3 grades of diastolic dysfunction with simple algorithms, for example, including e-velocity of the early diastolic lengthening of the left ventricle using velocity imaging of 7 or 10% at different sites. Now, there was a meta-analysis published last year, of which this is one illustration, testing the same criterion in those diagnostic recommendations and reaching the conclusion that there is insufficient evidence that this index can reliably estimate left ventricular filling pressure. Sensitivity, 37%, specificity, 91%. But if you go back to the imaging, we see E over E prime of 14 as one of the criteria for diagnosis in spite of this diagnostic performance. And when you look at the implication of these new diagnostic recommendations, these colleagues in Nancy, here in France, have looked at their Stanislav cohort, which is a population study that they have been conducting for some years, and using the criteria that I've just shown you, they found that if they looked at these velocity measurements over the age of 60, more than half of the population were abnormal. Now, we cannot use diagnostic tests that call everyone diseased. That's medicalization of society, but it's not useful because it doesn't discriminate. So this is a non-evidence-based consensus recommendation. Please, go ahead.
Do you think here that pharma companies intervene? I mean, for them it would be positive. They could sell more medicine. What's your...
That's a very cynical point of view.
the lobbyism, in fact.
I don't think they had anything to do with this. But
indirectly, probably, it's through the guidelines.
In clinical guidelines, there are hidden influences on which drugs get into the guidelines faster than other drugs. I think that's probably true. But I don't think it's probably true here. But yes, I mean, we could debate that. It's a political point, if you like. But what I want to show you is 4 different recommendations for diagnosing diastolic disease tested in the same population of 1,485 subjects, and you can see, for example, above the age of 60 years, that compared with the previous consensus recommendations, the new ones have mysteriously reduced the prevalence of the disease by a factor of 4, from 12 to 3%. Now, that may be appropriate, it may be good. The point is, this is just based on consensus, it's not based on evidence. And it has huge implications for whether we use drug treatment and so on. And this is a slide from Partho Sengupta in the States. It's not yet published. It's based on 130 subjects. But what they have done is compare the interrelationships between multiple echocardiographic measurements of cardiac function according to these four grades of diastolic function from normal to grade 3. And you see that all these variables are interrelated, which is not surprising. If you've got a diseased heart, it will be abnormal in multiple ways. If it's healthy, most measurements will be normal. But it does show, for example, at the top, you can hardly see this, ejection fraction. And you can see that that has few correlations because the density of the line relates to the strength of the associations between these factors. So ejection fraction is not really relevant to diastolic function, but we have end-diastolic and end-systolic volumes which do relate to many of these measurements, which might, for example, mean that they are load-dependent measurements, which may be relevant. But the point is, when everything's interrelated, how do you find the measurements that are most useful in clinical practice? And that's a challenge. My interpretation of that data is that the more severe the disease, the more everything is abnormal. Interrelationships are much stronger than in healthy subjects. As I've said, ejection fraction doesn't seem to be important. That's why I think it's the wrong measurement that we should make in these patients. And these are, of course, associations. They're not causal relationships. And selecting one or two things, as you might do in a consensus document, may be making the wrong selection. And different measurements might give you the diagnosis and tell you the prognosis. So it's quite complicated. Now, what about guidelines in general? I've shown those examples. This was a paper published in 2009 analyzing the evidence behind guidelines from the American College of Cardiology and the American Heart Association. And I just highlight echocardiography, where 100% of the recommendations were based on no evidence. Not an impressive total, but that was their analysis at that time. In other words, we should not call these guidelines in the sense of modern medicine, which is a systematic review of the evidence. These are consensus statements of colleagues making a recommendation, which is also helpful, but we can't pretend that this is a summary of good evidence. We need to do better than that. Within imaging, because of the lack of evidence, people have gone to using and publishing what are called appropriateness criteria. And that is a consensus of experts agreeing when it is appropriate to use a test for a particular indication. And this is a recent example from the European Association of Cardiovascular Imaging in heart failure, and they have graded these indications and the tests as appropriate or inappropriate or unknown. But the point of this is not just that you have this now if you wish, but this was based on a vote of national representatives from all the national member states of the European Society of Cardiology to the European Association of Cardiovascular Imaging. It's not based on analysis of evidence. This, to me, is not a substitute for evidence. It's just a step along the way. And indeed, Tom Marwick and colleagues published 2 years ago a review of whether or not having appropriateness criteria in cardiology had changed clinical practice in the use of diagnostic imaging. And you can see transthoracic echo compared at different times, transesophageal echo, stress echo, and then this is CT angiography, computed tomography, and nuclear SPECT perfusion imaging of the ventricle. Different diagnostic tests, all of which had been associated, or for which there had been appropriateness criteria published, and you can see that in many cases there was no impact of these criteria. For example, with stress echo, it didn't make the test being used more often and more appropriately. So I am skeptical about the value of appropriateness criteria. It may be an intermediate stage, but we still need evidence. And so I've been critical of guidelines, but they should represent a transparent, retestable review of the evidence. Like any scientific statement, you should be able to retest its validity. And the same should be true, in my opinion, for guidelines. They represent the apex of a pyramid at which we start with original data, if you like. But for me, what would be most important to make these useful is to have the ability to go from the statement at the top to the hinterland underneath to see the evidence on which that statement is based, so that you can see whether or not you agree with that. Now, we could have digital interactive guidelines that take you into the database that can be built up by a collective effort, like a wiki in medical evidence, but we're at the very early stages of doing that, and the European Society of Cardiology has not started to do that. I've suggested it to them years ago. I hope it'll come eventually, but this is what we need. Now, I'm going to move on to discuss how we use diagnostic tests and then make some concluding statements. Let me show you a patient just for a moment. This is a 24-year-old man who was stabbed by a knife in a fight in the epigastrium, and the stab went up towards the heart. He arrived in the emergency room bleeding from his epigastrium, and he had an emergency CT scan which showed blood in the pericardial cavity around the heart. And so he was taken straight to the operating theater by the cardiothoracic surgeons. And he had a transesophageal echo in the operating theater. And you can see a hole in the ventricular septum. He has a traumatic ventricular septal defect with a shunt from the left ventricle to the right ventricle. So while they were doing the scan, they also looked at the tricuspid valve. That should be running. And you can, in fact, see an abnormality of the tricuspid valve with mobile tissue, with prolapse of the leaflet, and with tricuspid regurgitation. So both of those problems were identified, and he had surgery to repair a hole in the wall of the heart. He was very lucky to survive, and to repair a ventricular septal defect. And one of the papillary muscles to the tricuspid valve had been cut, and so that was repaired. And then he came off the cardiopulmonary bypass. They did another scan to check that everything was all right, and they looked at the mitral valve. And there is a ruptured cord, a flail anterior leaflet, and regurgitation of the mitral valve. So they needed to go back on bypass to do a second pump run and repair a cord that had been transected to the mitral leaflet. Now, this patient survived. He went home. He's alive. He's very lucky. But the point I want to make is that even at the first image, where you get seduced by this amazing picture of a stab wound causing a hole in the heart, we can see both tricuspid and mitral regurgitation, but they didn't notice it. So if you go to the literature and you think about how we as fallible human beings use diagnostic imaging, this is one analysis. There are very few of 254 cases, and this is from pediatric echocardiography in Boston. But it shows that if you look at the reasons for diagnostic error, the most common ones are cognition, how we think about imaging. And amongst those, underinterpretation, 21%, and distraction by other diagnoses. You see something amazing, you get excited, you deal with it, but you don't look systematically at everything else. Incomplete examination and underinterpretation. And I just showed you an example where, fortunately, the whole examination was completed before the patient's operation was finished. But we need to be systematic. And if you're interested in looking at the general context of diagnostic imaging in clinical practice and how we improve quality, I commend to you this nice report from the National Academy of Science in the USA, published 2 years ago, on improving diagnosis. But what we need to think about is why this happens. And you probably, some of you know the book Thinking Fast by Daniel Kahneman. Pat Crosskerry is a physician in Canada who has studied medical thinking with psychologists and published much. But the same concept from both these authors is that when we have a clinical problem to solve, when we think, we tend to default to type 1 thinking, which is very fast. We see something, we make a diagnosis. Whereas we could stop and think and consider, be deductive and deliberate and scientific, and reduce the risk of error, but it takes longer. Now, paradoxically, as we train as imaging specialists in medicine, we're taught to make a quick diagnosis. We pride ourselves, we sit in the front row of a meeting, we see something, and in 2 seconds, I know what that is. That's not sensible. You should stop and think, because that's how we make errors. In fact, this process is driven by biases. We, for example, what's available will be given more prominence than things we have to spend time to find. We use heuristics, which are mental shortcuts, to reach a diagnosis. And what we need to do when we teach imaging as a specialty, in which you can think about, is metacognition, which means thinking about thinking and how it works in clinical practice. And we are all prone to different influences, including habit and fashion in diagnosis, and there are trends in overdiagnosis. These are examples on the left with echo in one patient, and on the right here with magnetic resonance imaging in a second patient with left ventricular non-compaction. You can see the abnormal pattern at the apex of the ventricle, and when you image in short axis between these arrows, you get this very strange picture of non-compacted myocardium at the apex of the left ventricle. And you can see the same thing here on magnetic resonance images of the heart on that patient. But this is now a common diagnosis. Yet when you look at healthy subjects, you will find that in some segments of the left ventricle, 80 to 100% of subjects will have evidence of non-compaction. So this is a normal phenomenon in a small degree in everybody, but it's diagnosed commonly now as a disease. Sometimes it is really a disease, but sometimes it's overdiagnosis. And one of the groups that has published most on this condition from Zurich published this paper a few years ago where they showed the increase in diagnosis of this disease over years. And they showed that in the most recent period that they reported, half of the patients were asymptomatic. Well, to me, that means half of the patients don't have the disease. But they're reporting it as a disease, and I think it's an example of one of the dangers that we must try to argue against, which is overdiagnosis. So, if I'm still staying to Switzerland, you're probably aware in aviation safety and accident causation and in big business with Six Sigma processes for manufacturing, how people use the Swiss cheese model of accident causation, which is if you take multiple slices of Emmental, if you line them up and the holes are aligned, you can start with your input and you can end up with an error. I've translated this to diagnostic practice, where we might have imperfect tests, inaccurate machines, an operator-dependent technique where the skill and the thinking and the experience of the operator becomes very important, which is true in imaging, and where we don't think properly. If all these things can happen, we can make a mistake with diagnosis, and you can see how this happens. I've spoken already about left ventricular function. I'll just show you a couple of slides about diagnosing coronary artery disease or ischemia, which is an interest of mine. And here is an image that was used in Sweden some years ago by colleagues. Equalis is a Swedish national quality control system for laboratory tests and diagnosis. And they include an imaging arm. It's one of the few countries where I'm aware that this happens. And every year they put some images on the web for all the hospitals to report the same images, which is a very nice system that I think more of us should use. So this is an image of the left ventricle that was reported by 106 Swedish hospitals. And you can see six segments of this left ventricle, which they had to grade from normal to hypokinesis to akinesis to dyskinesis. And you see that the distribution of diagnoses is a normal distribution. And very often you find segments which are virtually impossible to see, where half of the population said it was healthy and half said it was abnormal. That makes it difficult for clinical practice and so on. I won't go through all these examples. But we tend to diagnose myocardial function with visual analysis, and this just is one demonstration of the poor reproducibility of visual analysis of images. So when we do stress echocardiography now, if we have a poor quality image like this, one way that we're supposed to cope with this is by using echocardiographic contrast to show the cavity of the left ventricle, and you can certainly see in this patient that it improves the recognition of the lateral wall very well, but this patient also has some early hypertensive heart disease, and there's an abnormal pattern of motion in the septum that still is very difficult to interpret. This is still qualitative. We can just see it better, but we still have to make a visual judgment. What I think we should be doing is measuring function and making an objective diagnosis. And what we do is quantitative stress echocardiography using myocardial velocity imaging, measuring the velocities at the base of the left ventricle in six sites, three imaging planes, at rest and on exercise. And we did a study 15 years ago of myocardial Doppler in stress echocardiography. And we showed that just measuring these velocities on their own did not work very well. Two-thirds accuracy. But when we used these measurements with a model that adapted the responses for age and heart rate and gender, we got up to 90% or more accuracy with an objective test. A very good test, at that time probably the best non-invasive test for ischemia, but it's almost never used. I still do it because we did the research, but it's not available on diagnostic imaging systems. And the reason is, again, because of the fact that the companies do not have the responsibility to put software on their systems. If they did, they would have to demonstrate to the regulators that the software was accurate. They would need to pay for the research to do this. At the moment, that's not required. So it's an example of where I think we have a tool that would be helpful, but it's not available. So those are my clinical examples. If you'll allow me, I think we have a little bit more time, I want to discuss some more general concepts about clinical research that are pertinent to diagnostic imaging as well as other fields. Firstly, the World Medical Association is responsible for the Declaration of Helsinki. How many of you are familiar with that? Those of you who are engineers and PhDs, you've heard of it. So it's the basic principle for good clinical practice and appropriate ethical behavior when we do clinical research. But it includes the statement, which is why I mention it here, that all research involving human subjects must be registered publicly in an accessible database, and we have ethical obligations to publish and disseminate the results of the research, which is interesting. When you do any research involving patients, we have a duty to report it. And that's so that the results from patients who volunteered their time and perhaps some risk can be shared with everyone, so that other people don't need to have the same risk, and so that other researchers can build and benefit from what you already know. So how do we perform in imaging? Well, this is an analysis in the USA from studies funded by the National Heart, Lung, and Blood Institute, published a few years ago, looking at the cumulative publication rate months after completing trials. And those that involved devices and surrogate endpoints, such as diagnostic tests, and that's what we do with imaging mostly, as I've said, only 50% were published at 2.5 years, and even at 5 years, 20% of studies had still not been published. So we tend to under-register diagnostic research and not to publish at all, which is not what we should be doing if you apply the Declaration of Helsinki. Another consideration, and this is a nice paper if you're curious about this, it shows the serendipity of citation in medicine. This was a review published in the British Medical Journal in 2009 of how citations can be distorted. And they started in 1992 with two authority papers with a new statement. And then they traced the citation pattern from those original sources into reviews, into models, and into other types of publications. And all the black lines are supportive. But soon after the original publication, there had been several other studies that were critical, that showed that the original publication was not correct. That's how science should operate. No criticism involved in that. But subsequently, people are still reporting the original publication as truth hundreds of times, many years later. That's what happens. And this is a very nice example, if you want to read it, that you could follow. So in fact, if we report our research, we should try to find what's been published before, and we should go back to the original sources to be logical.
I completely get your point. I'm just thinking that maybe critical publications might not be cited also because they can be criticized. So the supportive or critical publication standard point of view is not related to the truth, actually, at least, of the evidence.
You're correct. It's a serendipitous process, and to some extent it's luck whether you get your publications into the common framework. And if you've been cited once or twice, people cite citations rather than go back to cite original sources. And we all do this, but I try and get fellows to read the original papers and not to cite reviews, but to go back if possible. But there is such an enormous amount of literature, it is impossible now. So to some extent, we can't really criticize this. We should just try and act against it. And this is where we need digital repositories of knowledge that are curated collectively and summarized collectively.
And accessible publications also, because
yeah.
when it's closed for young researcher, not PhDs, but even before, it's yeah. very difficult to access publications, mm-hmm. even in school, engineering schools.
Yeah. So now, if we think what we're doing is good quality, read this publication from Ioannidis in California. Very nice paper in the Public Library of Science in the USA suggesting that most research is false. If you look at the diagnostic power and prevalence of findings, and here are practical examples, the positive predictive value of these studies goes down to virtually nothing. But it's a nice statistical analysis of objectively thinking about the chance that you will actually make a difference and that what you found is correct. And I'd also like to quote Peter Medawar. I don't know if any of you know his name, but he was a Nobel laureate in medicine from London who did some of the key basic work on rejection of tissue as a foundation for transplantation, on tissue immunity and the immune response. But he says that the scientific paper is a fraud because you manipulate how you write things to make it appear as if everything is exact and you know, but he says any observation in fact is prejudiced, it's related to what we know, what we think we've seen, how we interpret it, and there's truth in that. Formulation of an idea and demonstration of proof are different activities, and it's not logically possible to arrive with certainty at any generalization. We know this from the philosophy of science, that every hypothesis can be disproved. So how do we cope with this? Well, I think one of the issues is actually open data, is publishing the original sources so that we can reanalyze data. And there is a move to do this now in imaging research as well. It's been spearheaded, for example, by this campaign from the British Medical Journal saying that in the future, an essential characteristic of good science is sharing of the data, not just the publications and the result. In fact, this is being done. The European Medicines Agency, from last October, now makes it compulsory for any new drug that's released on the market that the data are available through their website, for example, an interesting initiative. But this has been studied very little, but I could find one publication from Shah Ebrahim and colleagues, and this is in the Cochrane Collaboration for Imaging, but they, for cardiology, I should say, they reported 37 studies where data were made accessible and the data had been reanalyzed. So there are very few studies of what this means. But from that, I took out three studies because they're all about diagnostic imaging. And here is one of coronary artery disease with left ventricular dysfunction, measuring ejection fraction. The original data showed no difference. They reanalyzed it with a computer-assisted algorithm, and they found that one drug was better than the other. So the outcome was changed by objective computer analysis of the left ventricular function. A second example, in patients with transplantation, they measured intima media thickness. I've already questioned its value, but they reanalyzed it with site-to-site matched analysis, excluding patients with poor quality, and changed the outcome of the study. And the final example was of magnetic resonance imaging to look at stroke and the degree of brain damage. The initial analysis showed no difference. It was reanalyzed with a different measurement, and they did show a difference. So here are three examples where open access to data, where imaging was key, and where it had been done more thoroughly, more objectively, better methods, gave a different answer. And there's a message there.
Quick question. Could you comment on negative results and the publication bias caused by this?
You've made the point, of course, that negative studies are more difficult to publish. But that's one reason why clinical trials databases are now insisting that you report your results, at least on the web, in a summary on a clinical trials database. And that is still not done in all cases, but that may become a requirement. What I didn't say is that the NHLBI in the States, who published those publication rates after the completion of a trial, have now this year, because of that, said that if you take money from them as a grant and if you don't publish your results, they will not give you another grant. So they have made that compulsory. The problem there, of course, is that they don't control the journals. And we all know that if you send a negative paper to a journal, it's more difficult to get it published. So it may be that open access publishing on the web without journals might be a way to deal with this in future. And that would just put the responsibility on us always to be critical of what we're reading. But that should be the same as what happens even if it's in a journal. So we now have large population databases with imaging. For example, the biobank in the United Kingdom is doing magnetic resonance imaging on 100,000 subjects. And MESA, multi-ethnic studies of atherosclerosis in the States, has published very interesting papers. We have other examples of international collaborations to collect very large numbers of subjects and to make the raw data available for open access imaging. So I think we're moving to a new era where things will improve. I think the ultimate test for any diagnostic test, as published by these earlier proponents of evidence-based medicine, is that the ultimate criterion for the usefulness of any diagnostic test is that it leads to a change in management that benefits the patient. So our imaging tools should make a difference to patients and their clinical outcomes. But we need to test that, and that's difficult in clinical trials, but it's where we should be moving. We don't do it already for various reasons, including this one which I've already mentioned about the way that we regulate diagnostic imaging systems. Now, I'm going to show you a couple of references, and I trust that these slides will be available to you all afterwards if you want to read these. But if you want to look at imaging in clinical trials, there was a nice publication from the American Society of Echocardiography in 2004, and there's also one from the European Association of Cardiovascular Imaging using echo Doppler and clinical trials from 2011, and they're both good documents. And if you want to look at the context of developments in imaging from a clinical perspective, we published a paper 10 years ago on the future of cardiovascular imaging, talking about the need for collaboration between engineers and clinical specialists, the need for clinical trials based on outcomes, the need for comparative assessment of multimodality imaging, and very similar points have been made recently by US colleagues in a similar and much more detailed publication where they identify priorities for future developments, which I'm not going to go through in detail, but they include many of the things that I've mentioned with big data and careful analysis of multiple imaging modalities. And there are publications from them on priorities for technological and research development, including bringing engineers and scientists and cardiologists together, including proper assessment of guidelines and standards, including software and hardware development, and research topics on reproducibility, feasibility, cost effectiveness, and all these things that I've touched on. And my final paper that I wanted to highlight is actually a rather interesting study from the USA, published last year in JACC, showing the variability in the use of echocardiography across different states in the US. And you can see large variability, the Eastern Seaboard tending to use ultrasound much more than the Midwest and the south of the states. They analyzed data from 3.6 million hospitalizations. So this is big data, simple analysis. But interestingly, they showed that where patients had had an echocardiogram during admission for stroke or heart failure or sepsis or acute myocardial infarction, patients who had echoes did better, had a better prognosis than patients who didn't have echoes. And yet they looked at the prevalence of using echo in these populations in red, and you can see it's only 10% or less on average. So actually their conclusion is that probably we do too few echoes. If we did them in all these groups of patients, we might have an impact on outcomes. And from such a large big data set, it's actually an interesting conclusion, but it's only going to be true if we apply it with quality. So I have two final slides, I think. We talk a lot in medicine now about translation from bench to bedside. It's a cliche. Basic research should have an impact on clinical disease and vice versa. I think we should be doing the same with engineering, that what we are developing as diagnostic tools should be related to a logical analysis of pathophysiology so that together we decide what the target is. I think a lot of developments in imaging are led by technological change, and then you go and see how it can help us in imaging in patients. It should, if possible, be the other way around. So also, when we have new diagnostic tests, they should relate to clinical outcomes. And this is my final slide with some key points that concepts that I want to suggest for you. I've said that diagnostic error is common, so we need to develop critical thinking skills. Our machines are fallible. We need to understand their technical features and assess how they compare with each other. Visual analysis is unreliable, so we need to have objective measurements. We need to know the reproducibility of our measurements, and I think we should report the uncertainty that goes with reduced reproducibility. Because in clinical practice, we balance multiple probabilities using all the integrated sources of information we can get. We have to make a judgment to our best ability for a patient. But that should include a judgment about the certainty or uncertainty of the diagnostic test. And of course, it should be interpreted by the pretest probability. That's a Bayesian approach where the type of patient will determine how much we believe the results of the test. I've said that I think in many measurements now we can see that the progression from health to disease is continuous. So defining normality becomes arbitrary, which is an interesting concept, and overdiagnosis is common. So we need to choose a logical target for imaging, also measure responses during stress, validate our tests against independent reference criteria, and study their impact on clinical outcomes. there's a huge agenda, and it's not about technological change, it's about how we think and use the results that we get to improve our thinking skills and our clinical application. And I think it all depends on medical decision support and harnessing the revolution of the internet age to help us as clinicians. So, I'm finished. I hope there's still time for a few questions before coffee. Thank you very much.
Thanks a lot for the brilliant talk. I think these are really proper guidelines we should all follow.
So thanks for the talk. What I am concerned about as a clinical cardiologist is on the topic on the guidelines, that most ALCTRI studies are excluding a lot of a population of patients, which are our regular patients. I am thinking about all the people, for example, with renal insufficiency, when I'm thinking about drugs, for example, and 40% of my patients in my daily clinical basis to 50% are over 80 and have other comorbilities that have never, that would always be excluded for any of the major trials because of those comorbilities. So my problem is that a lot of times, even taking into account all the problems with guidelines that you said, also even if the studies were perfect, which are not, I cannot apply it in most of my patients. I just have to guess more or less or extrapolate from these other studies. Mm. That's one of my...
I absolutely agree with you, Ada. Yeah. I started by talking about the Western model of medicine, and in fact it's been highly successful. We're living longer, but now most patients with cardiovascular disease are older. They're in their 60s and 70s and 80s and 90s. But those patients are rarely included in clinical trials, and also we don't always include them in diagnostic studies because they have poorer image quality, and we like to test our methods where we have good image quality. So you're absolutely right that real-world experience, feasibility, is one of my criteria for how we assess a test. Can you use it in clinical practice?
So I want to comment on the last thing, which I really appreciate, the cooperation between engineers and medical doctors. So I can just tell that that I'm an engineer, and I work actually at the Charité, a big in Berlin, at the big university hospital. And principally, we have a very nice cooperation with the medical doctors, and it's very easy going. But it's very difficult as well, because they don't have time at all, even though they do a lot of research, but they're completely overloaded, which makes it very difficult for us to work together. And I think this is a critical point I have been discussing already earlier, or a couple of days ago, that in fact the medical doctors, they would need more time for research in order to have more time to cooperate as well with us. This is critical. I mean, it leads, and then another point is big problem in at the Charité. We have a kind of bad image, I sometimes think, because they are so working so tough and hard, and then this guy from the research lab is coming at 9 o'clock, you know, they are working at 7 o'clock already starting, and they just think often I'm a lazy guy, you know, and don't appreciate.
So you need to start at 6 o'clock, and then you get their respect.
Exactly, that's not fair. You know? So what do you think about this?
Your comments are very valid. Two observations. That's one reason why I said we need to teach our medical students how to think more, to be more reflective on what they do that may be misguided or inappropriate, or where they might have errors in practice that you can try to reduce by thinking about your own biases and everything else. And also, there is an issue in medicine, as you say, we're all very busy, we're all very subspecialized, that we need to try to get expert colleagues to advise us. And in clinical cardiovascular medicine, I think there is a tendency that trialists who do large controlled trials that produce the evidence about efficacy of drugs may not be expert in imaging, which is a very specialist field, and they need to use the best tests, not the ones they happen to know or that their friends happen to tell them, but how you summarize what's most appropriate or not is very difficult. And there's no answer. The world is imperfect. We just keep trying.
Just had maybe a comment. No later than yesterday, we were doing some GLS measurements. And a typical thing when you don't get the right value is that you rerun the procedure. Just to see if the new value is better according to what you were expecting.
And when you're sampling the ventricle, if you don't like one trace, you go somewhere else and you like that trace and you take that. I mean, this is intra-observer variability. It's implicit in the methods, but we should be aware of what we're doing.
Yeah.
And maybe, I think in clinical practice, if you understand the method, you can factor into your decision-making the imprecision of the or the variability of the test. That's what we do.
But also maybe we should document the traces. At least it's an idea that our colleague Pascal is defending often. That this feedback, whenever the a measurement is not judged as correct by the physician, that this feedback would somehow be archived and sent back to the manufacturer or the.
But there's another problem now, which is that we see things we've not seen before and we don't know what they mean, because we're studying disease in so much detail that we see subclinical changes or regional patterns of disease that may be things that we haven't recognized before. The most recent international classification of disease lists 13,500 diagnoses in medicine. None of us know all those, and that's only the start of the process. But there are others that we don't yet recognize. As we look at interrelationships between the genome and the phenome, there will be more that we have to discover. So what we think is noise might be real, but we just don't know it yet. That's another problem.
Just a curiosity, when you show that there is differences between men, women, Asian, South Asian, and European, is it based, do you actually do measurements in Asia, South Asia, and so on, or you do in Europe with people who live in Europe are of Asian origin?
Those data that I showed were from population studies done in each country. And it means that when you have diagnostic guidelines written in the USA, they may not be applicable in Japan or Burma or I should call it Myanmar or Australia or whatever. Absolutely. So you should almost do it for your own hospital, but that's too much. We have to compromise somewhere.
What's the effect of tea versus coffee?
Yeah, just to quickly comment on that, a lot is probably related to size also.
Yep.
Even we don't know what the reason is. Is it genetic or is it just sheer size? Like, same with men and women, it's mostly size, but we don't know. But maybe to go a little bit further, when you see an imaging and some of the problems and some of the tools, what you have mentioned, there is a big role for the companies, for the vendors. Now, when you see the model that they currently use to kind of market their products in some ways, is that each of them has every year kind of to produce a new feature, which they then give to an eminent cardiologist, which then will publish it and which will talk about it and will always say that his or her tool is better than what the other has or the previous has. And there is absolutely no incentive to incorporate the data that you give, for example, some of the things like uncertainty or which is clinically relevant, yes or no. Do you think that this is intrinsic to the way they do more their marketing, I think, rather than development? Or is there a role for professional societies to do something about it and kind of push the manufacturer to something? Or what's the problem and what's the solution?
Thank you. There is no short answer to those questions, is there? Companies need to make a profit. We need to respect that. They need to pay for their R&D departments. So that's perfectly reasonable, and they want to promote what they develop. So it's not a collective exercise, and it may never be, and it couldn't be. Maybe we need to accept that. Equally, academics also have their own vested interests because they build careers on the latest measurement or the latest technology that you provide for them. And we need to recognize that as well. You can have bias without any association with a company just because it's your idea that you're promoting. So we also reward academic physicians on the basis of their publication records and whether or not they're able to promote what they do. So actually, science should be a collaboration. It shouldn't be about publishing more papers than anybody else. It should be about contributing to the common good. But that's a huge philosophical question, isn't it, about modern society and the climate we live in. But those values would help us to collaborate, which is what basically you're saying we need, both between companies and amongst researchers, to try to identify common truth more rapidly than by the competition and serendipity that we have at the moment.
But so related to that, Pashi, especially when you look at the initiative of standardization of strain, yeah. Should there be more initiatives like this where the society kind of forces yeah. the manufacturers to sit together and say, like, so, look, guys, this is a clear problem, yeah. solve it.
So I showed that example. I think it's the first, and we've now seen the magnetic resonance community are trying to do the same. And so I think it's a very good precedent that others should follow. And that was taken by professional associations. And I think you may well be right that if we cannot expect companies to produce the sophisticated diagnostic support software, then somebody else should do it, and we should do it collectively through our professional associations. But for that to be successful, it needs to be a company that's selling its product and making money so that it can be marketed and become self-sustaining. And that's a different philosophy from what most of us have. That's the issue. It needs somebody to take this initiative and to set up a common process that can build decision support software where we can integrate into the decision support the variability, the reproducibility of the system and the patient's characteristics so that we can interpret results by the pretest probability of using the test in that patient and where we can interpret it by subclinical disease related to risk factors to see whether there are additive degrees of abnormality that might be due to some other condition. That's all hypothetically possible, but I'm not yet aware of any good system that does that internationally. I agree with you, that's what we really should take as a perspective for the next 5, 10, 15 more years to try and develop.
It's a very broad question, maybe not directly related to that, but what are your take on the weight of the regulation related to the technological advancement? I'm meaning I completely go with the fact that we need regulation to be wary of what we do. But sometimes, for example, for data acquisition and for stuff like this, it can be a little bit of a break on technological advancements. Yeah. What are your take on that?
Another difficult question, and there is no simple answer. The usual argument is that if we have too much regulation, we will hinder innovation and new advances will not be implemented. And many academic clinical imaging specialists also don't want more regulation because they like to get new tools from the imaging companies that we can build careers on, if you like, to be unfair and simplistic, but that we can develop and promote. I think we need more responsibility on manufacturers to give us more information about how their systems perform, and that could be done by regulatory authorities. We could also give companies the responsibility, after they have permission to manufacture and sell their systems, to help to collect the data afterwards that we need for clinical application. Might not need to be done before approval, before something is marketed, but I think they should share in the costs of developing the evidence afterwards. And we need professional collaborations. I don't want to stop new ideas because we don't know what's going to work and what isn't. They need to be done. But also, one could argue from the perspective of health technology assessment and from funding bodies that it is not possible anymore to pay for everything that is possible unless it makes a difference. So we need to work together. It's another example of where you really need clinical and engineering colleagues and clinical healthcare and industry to work together to find out what's most effective.
So I'm changing gears a little bit, but so I find that maybe these guidelines and those numbers and the reproducibility and all of this, is good for managing a population in a statistical sense. But when you have one patient in front of you, I'm not a doctor, but when you have one patient in front of you, medicine becomes an art again. You know, this patient may be in the high level of distress, maybe his wife is there, really wants to give him something, maybe he's too old and he has cancer, and you know, you want to do something else. So in that sense, isn't that good enough that you get a ballpark of, you know, that's more or less in this area, this patient sits, and then considering everything else, psychological factors and all, I'm going to make my decision on that. So that, you know, the numbers where the ejection fraction is 40 and 50, it just doesn't matter anymore?
It's an interesting point, and you're correct that when we're dealing with individual patients, it often does come down to judgment and experience and balancing multiple probabilities. I think one of the biggest challenges for clinicians now is when you have an individual patient to try to apply in the individual case the evidence. You may have a 90-year-old with severe valve disease where you know that something is theoretically possible, but you also realize that on balance you're going to improve survival by 1 month for a huge cost. But to say no to that patient is quite hard sometimes, and that depends on experience and judgment and how you discuss it with the patient. We also need to involve patients in these decisions. Though they may be wiser than us sometimes, they often say they don't want something done. They realize that because we all are mortal. But you know, you're raising very appropriate issues. And I did show the implication in one patient of the reproducibility of a test. And that's something I think we should use much more often, is to understand the implications in individual patients of the reproducibility of individual tests when we make clinical decisions. And probably most colleagues don't do that. So there are things we can do, but you're quite right, it'll never be a completely logical decision, if you like. It will also be an art. That's what medicine's about, and that's part of the challenge and the privilege, if you like, as well, of doing that.
There is a recent initiative by the FDA for use of in silico models for testing different, drugs or whatever. Do you think that is also applicable for the medical tool, like for echography or other devices that are
absolutely. And the FDA now has a research division, and I've met one of the leaders of that group, so that they are doing multi-system, not for an individual company, but across a generic problem. They are developing laboratory tools for standardization. And I think that's, again, like the in silico model, where virtual truth was known for the modeling of the ventricle that's been done between companies, and we could do much more of that. The new European medical device law that becomes law this year includes the provision for reference laboratories for the first time in Europe for standardization of medical devices. And these may be promoted either by a national regulatory authority or by the Joint Research Centre of the European Commission, which is going to be responsible for managing scientific input into evaluation of devices. And so the concept will be possible for example, a European standard reference laboratory for bench testing in silico and in phantoms of diagnostic imaging. And I think we should be working towards that.
The in silico supposes that the human physiology is like a machine in a certain way. And what is your idea about this? Like, you said about the uncertainty between population, but once you are working with in silico models, you are supposed to be far.
I think it very much depends what you use them for. And again, you appreciate their limitations and benefits. I'm not an expert. I'm was thinking recently about the fact that so many people are working on developing models of the heart. They're becoming more and more sophisticated. In fact, the better they become, the more like they become the real thing. So why not just study the real thing? So at some point, trying to make the models perfect becomes illogical to me, because you've basically got what you can study in a biological model in patients. But for the right question and with the right model, I'm sure they're useful. And I really need advice from engineering colleagues as to where you think that's most appropriate.
I think it's indeed an interesting discussion. And actually, partially what you have been said of the medical world is that you have experts that take the literature and take just part of it into the guidelines based on whatever reason that they either can't look at it, everything, can't know everything, or their other interests. Exactly the same happens in the modeling community, unfortunately. Engineers are no different than medical doctors. And there also is like, we have to see what's the evidence and what can you use them for. And unfortunately, some of our colleagues promote it as a replacement, indeed, of clinical studies, where for some things it can't work. For other things, like, for example, the standardization based on phantoms, which are based on in silico models, that's exactly what we should use them for at this stage. Obviously, there's still research going on. But there again, we have to look critically at what we can use when, and there's a lot of politics involved, unfortunately, also. Maybe I want to come back just a minute to this first question on the individual and the art of medicine in some ways. The other thing is, which you maybe haven't emphasized a lot, is that actually these guidelines, although we know their limitations and their faults, are actually used in some countries for training, that the exam of medical doctors is based on whether you know the guidelines or not. They don't care whether you can treat a patient properly or not. You need to know the guidelines. And on the other hand, there's a lot of lawsuits involving millions of mostly dollars on whether you have followed these guidelines, yes or no. So the art of medicine at some point is limited by regulations and training. So there is this still this problem. So I think these guidelines are very, very important that they are accurate enough, because there are a lot of implications behind just the individual patient.
Yes, you're quite right. They're not supposed to be legal documents, but they are used by default in claims against physicians if something has happened, because there's nothing else. And lawyers don't view them the same way that we view them. There's one recent interesting example, which I haven't studied in detail, but which I've heard about. The American Society of Echocardiography published some guidelines recently on imaging to detect sources of embolism. And that document has a long legal disclaimer at the end of the document saying these are consensus recommendations. They are not intended to be law. If anything happens, we are not responsible, etc., etc. That's the first time that that's happened, and it's a backlash against the overuse of what are supposed to be recommendation documents, whereas, as you say, medicine will always be an individual human being as a patient and an individual human being as the physician, trying to do the best they can in difficult circumstances, and that's not always a scientific process, and it shouldn't be, and it can't be. It's about judgment and probabilities and personal circumstances and all sorts of things.
I have a comment maybe from a vendor point of view. So what I heard from your talk is that you would like imaging to move a little bit from just showing images to a measurement tool. And in this respect, I think that all the what we heard about how to calibrate, how to ensure that the measurements are more accurate, you know, as reproducible as possible, as accurate as possible, I think that's really something that is on the, let's say, on the plate of the vendors to make it happen, but also on the plate of the regulation, because if they are more strict and they impose that, I think we've seen it's difficult within a company to promote that, because there's no incentive really to make it more accurate. You can make it, I don't know, faster. You can make it nicer, easier to use. It's more, you know, it's a better incentive for the sales than making it working on a benchmark of two. So, but that's, I think that's very clear, and for me it's very important. The second step that vendors sometimes do, and you were also calling a bit for that, is how to use that as a biomarker, or how to show that there is an impact on the outcome. And here I'm not sure what's the role of the vendors and what's the role of the clinicians, the guidelines. And for me, there are two issues. One of them is that it's very difficult. The vendors try to promote that, and they say, with this tool, you will be more able to separate your patient. And I don't think they should do that too much. On the other hand, measuring the outcome sometimes takes years. And for that, we don't really have tools. So in other domains of science, in engineering, simulations and models, where you know, make possible to increase the speed of time, and you can do see what materials how they will age. You can see what happens when you have a crash. You can simulate a lot of events that you cannot do with the body and physiology. So you have to wait years, mm-hmm. maybe mm-hmm. 10 years, 70 years, and you have to look at what happens at the patient. And for that, we don't have really the tools to speed up that process. So measuring the outcome and not have just surrogate biomarkers that are just worth what they are supposed to do, but maybe you have a drug that just has an impact on the surrogate and not on the underlying process. That's really a clinical and a medical question, and the vendors can help designing the tools, but not really on the outcome. And we also would like to hear what you think about also models to try to help understand the processes and how.
I think you're absolutely right. It's not the responsibility of manufacturers currently to assess what happens to their systems afterwards and how they're used. And that's a responsibility for the clinical academic community to produce the evidence whether or not these tests or tools make a difference. It's very difficult, and there are not yet very many good, large, randomized outcome trials of the impact of imaging on diagnosis. But it is expensive, and imaging can have side effects. If you miss a diagnosis that's important, or if you overdiagnose something that has consequences, so it can cause harm as well as improve decision making. So there is a responsibility there that what manufacturers release needs to be used appropriately, and I think we need to consider in detail between engineers and regulators and clinicians whether companies should share some of the responsibility to help to collect the evidence, probably as part of post-market surveillance. To me, that would be appropriate, because you can buy an expensive tool to image the heart, but whether you go on using it should depend on whether or not it's going to help you to do things better. And I think companies should have some of that responsibility. But exactly how, we need to consider in much more detail. And I don't want to stop innovation either, but equally there's no value in innovation if it doesn't have an impact. And if it's just providing us with nicer pictures, which you talked about, then that doesn't necessarily help. And a lot of three-dimensional imaging at the moment is producing amazing pictures, but we get the same decision support from simple functional measurements that might help us enough. Whether modeling can help with post-market analysis of outcomes, I rather doubt it. I think that has to be done with patients because of the multiple other variables involved. Probably we should have coffee, and I'm conscious.
Yeah. Let's thank again Alan for the great talk.
There is another session afterwards, Sergio. I apologize.
Innovation and you. Philips.